is based around an event that had taken place not that far from where I'm staying, and it was in a camp room, so it's very fitting. Also was terrifying to research, especially because I knew the story. I was like, yeah, I'll do it when I go up, and reading and researching it while being here, very creepy. So I am currently at a remote work site. I had to drive about 10 plus hours to get here because the work sites that you're on are in such remote locations, it's difficult to get to. There really isn't any hotels, towns, anything nearby at all. I think the closest thing to me is 2 hours away, or 1 hour and 45 minutes. So it's an isolating feeling, but they create these little worksite camp locations close to the site that you're working at, and then you don't have to have such a long commute, but you're away from home, you're away from your friends, your family, civilization for a long time sometimes. And I gotta tell you, driving alone to get here for that long is not fun. It's not as chill as driving up to a cabin like Maddie was, but you know, hey, what can you do? So I think that you guys are going to very much enjoy today's story. I'm going to start it off by kind of discussing what it's like to be here, what the day-to-day is like a little bit, just so you can have some context to this story. Because it's not like a nice hotel where something bad happened. It can be a lot in general just being here for some people, but I don't want to ramble too much, so I'll tell you a bit about being here in the background, and then we'll get into the story so you can have a full picture. Also, did we like this? Did we hate it? I see other people doing it, and I love it. And in addition to that, I traveled here with a ring light and my Blue Yeti microphone because, I mean, I'm going in blind. I hope it sounds good, but I felt more comfortable traveling with this than my fancier one. However, full disclosure, I am in a working camp, so I have neighbors who can hear. I can hear everything that they do, so at least I'm whispering. But if you hear them walking, I can't hear it as amplified as you, so sorry. So let's dive into things today, and let's get ourselves nice and comfortable. Ease your minds and grab yourself a nice glass of wine, like I would love to be having, a water, like myself. I don't have the pour factor, so I hope you can hear me kind of rocking it. Maybe you can, maybe you can't. A sparkling juice. Finish a last minute essay. Or dream about having a margarita, like myself and Ashley VR. And let's dive into the story of Daniel Goodridge. Daniel Goodridge and work camps. What? What is this story about? Well, I know a lot about camps. You may or may not. So let me educate you a little bit. Basically, as I mentioned, you're working in a remote area. You need somewhere to stay. And location that actually the story happened at was about 50 kilometers away from the nearest town. So quite a bit of a distance. And it can feel very isolating when something scary happens there. You almost feel out of control of anything and everything. But work camps can house a lot of people. During shutdowns, I've been up here and there's been definitely over 1,000. I'm not sure exactly how many, but well over 1,000 people in bunks as small as this. I have a bed here, a little TV, a sink, and a bathroom that my clothes are hanging on that I share with my neighbor. And I don't know my neighbor. COVID has made that not a thing anymore, but it was a thing for a long time. And essentially, if you're here with a large work group or billiards, lots of gyms, yoga studios, that type of thing. But for the most part, you're working 12-hour shifts. You're in a confined or congested space, at least with hundreds of people, sometimes thousands, that you don't know that well. Your privacy and your personal space goes completely out the window. And imagine you're there and you don't know that many people. Maybe you're just a contractor for a really small company and you don't have anyone that you really hang out with. Maybe you're working alone. A lot of people spend their shifts here, roughly 10 days on, 10 days off, and they will be working maybe 12 plus hours, 13 hours. So you don't have much personal time while you're here. And when you are here, you may or may not have people, whatever. It can become exhausting, stressful, depressing. And if you're not an overly positive person like myself, it is very difficult to maintain a happy day-to-day life. It is really exhausting, and it just can really bring, I've seen it bring down the happiest of people, myself included. If you have a bad day at work, you can't go home and escape it. You can't go have a nice glass of wine. You're stuck here for 10 and a half days. And just so you know, some people are here way longer, depending on your trade, what works for you. I have seen people here before, 7 days on, 1 day off, and they'd been here for about 4 months straight. No going home to family, no hanging out. Bit mental. But they do their best to make it as fun as they can, right? They have, some places have slushy machines, basketball courts, all types of things, but again, all about you. If work stresses you out, if you need to go home, have a beer, watch TV for a few hours, you don't get that much time. I literally had not much time to film this, and I have to be up at like 5 in the morning tomorrow, so I am going to be tired for you. And I gotta say, in relation to the shared bathroom, there is nothing worse than these paper thin walls where you can hear the person laying next to you sigh to themselves like, and waking up in your bed to the sound of someone you don't know using your bathroom, or worse, waking up to the smell. Anyway, so it can be a good place and it can be a bad place, but in general, it's gotten better with COVID. It's also gotten worse because now I can't leave my room. But anyway, that's just kind of a little bit about the camp life. But for the most part, you gotta bring your own water bottle to fill up at the end of the hall. And you can't bring in certain things, contraband items, because you could have a safety sensitive job position. They don't want a bunch of people here doing drugs, drinking, anything that could alter them remotely, because everybody has to work the next day. If you're here, you're working. And, I mean, it is a very, I mean, people can get stressed and do some pretty crazy things here, which is what we're going to be talking about today. And with today's story, I don't normally do disclaimers unless it makes me incredibly uncomfortable or it could be very triggering. And I'm just going to let you know that for this video, it is incredibly graphic, violent, torture me, and I will be keeping in all of the details, even though it makes me uncomfortable, but I am going to be reading it as it was documented, so warning, graphic content, gruesome details. So, Daniel Goodridge was a 28-year-old male at the time while working at a northern Alberta work camp. He had been employed as a cook and was known for being a bit odd. Now, it is very hard to find any information on this case other than basic facts, so I've built the story I can for you. It is not well documented. I couldn't find it anywhere, but I'd heard of it from, obviously, the grapevine, my fiance, live in Alberta. So Daniel, his entire life, was a very good guy. He was very easygoing, fun, and charismatic. But it was once normal behaviors. Over the years, he was actually even committed to a psychiatric facility under the Mental Health Act at least 7 times. And I live in Alberta. I visited my sister in some of those locations and facilities. And in Alberta, a person who is assessed by a doctor to be in need of observation, examination, assessment, treatment, and or intensive care may be held in a hospital against their will if they meet a certain criteria outlined in the Mental Health Act. So this is what they call being detained. Now, I'm not sure if he was detained or not, but based on the sentence that I'd said, he was committed to a psychiatric facility under the Mental Health Act. I think that may have been what had happened. And so I looked up what it was to be detained. And to do so, a doctor can do so if you have a mental disorder, are likely to cause harm to yourself or to others, or if you suffer a significant physical deterioration or seriously physical impairment, or if there's no other way to arrange for hospital admission, which usually means that you say, no, I'm not going to the hospital, and they're like, yeah, you are. So that's one of the ways a judge and a police officer can also do so to you. And a police officer has all of those elements, plus if you're not obeying them, it believes that it is due to a mental disorder, or if it's dangerous to your own safety and others, and you can't wait for a judge to issue a warrant. But even so, he'd been committed several times, so this fun charismatic boy was changing rapidly, and that can be the time frame when people's mental states can change. It's all different though with each diagnosis. But he was prescribed medications and he would not take them. He actually had a girlfriend later on named Chandra Cunningham who had never seen him take anything. But overall, he was described still as a kind, caring guy. And his girlfriend would say that they literally never fought in their relationship, and the first 5 months of their relationship were great. So, you know, after all the jumps and such through his adolescence and growing, it kind of evened out, but the behaviors were still there, still odd. And by the end of April of 2015, he'd acted even more strange. He'd had his odd behaviors, but they were very much escalating. And I'm sure that due to him being detained several times, he probably wasn't the type of guy that felt comfortable to come forward and say, hey, I'm not feeling mentally okay. I think I need to talk to someone. He was probably terrified. He was probably like, I'm fine. They're the ones that are, you know. But anyway, there wasn't much background of his upbringing or anything up until the moments I'd mentioned and the moments going forward. So he would actually disappear for days at a time and would tell others, specifically his girlfriend, that when she couldn't find him, he would go to the park so that he could be around trees, which I get that, if you're inside a lot. But he would actually sleep in the parks because it brought him power. And he then changed every picture in his phone to trees. Chandra said that one night he had stayed up all night at her apartment, and in the morning when she'd woken up, his shirt was on inside out and backwards, and he had gathered up every teal colored item in the apartment that he could find and was lying on top of his collection, claiming that they gave him powers. So he was clearly exhibiting abnormal behaviors and was clearly sick to some extent. So Chandra and Daniel did break up at the end of May in 2015. And the last time that she had seen him was June 20th, when she had went to his parents' home to collect some of the money that he'd owed her. In her words, he looked awful, not like himself, and had lost a significant amount of weight and looked overall exhausted. She thought he seemed upset, maybe depressed, but when she'd asked Daniel if he'd had any mental health problems or needed any help, he told her, "As far as I know, I don't." Again, not the type of guy that would probably open up about that because it seemed like he had bad experiences, and to be honest, he probably really didn't even know. He probably didn't take the step back to realize he needed help, and sometimes you're just too far past that point to be able to acknowledge it, you know? So if establishes ongoing mental health issues, he kind of lied to his girlfriend since he'd been in facility several times, but I mean, as far as he knows, he really didn't have any issues. And just because you go to one of those facilities doesn't necessarily mean that you are mentally ill. But regardless, let's continue the story. But there is a reason I am mentioning all of these things, and it is an important backup information for you to hear for later on. So Daniel was working one night as a cook in the Northern Alberta work camp Fox Creek. And leading up to June 30th, the day that we will be discussing, he was not in the best of headspaces. Again, that's why the background information for this is very important, especially what I'd mentioned before on simply being out there already being very stressful and uncomfortable for people. If you are someone who has experiences like this man and you're in a dark place, it may not necessarily be the best place for you. It's a lot on any person. So imagine how his thought process is right now. Not great. And I would like to say that it is, I myself have had to drive from the city several hours to go pick up a coworker who was having too stressful of a time and just needed to get out of here. So imagine someone in his perspective. So he'd spoken with his mother a few days beforehand, and she was genuinely concerned on his well-being. At this point in time, he had been off of his prescribed antipsychotic medication for months and was getting increasingly paranoid and delusional. But the stress didn't help. He was completely overwhelmed by his job. His cell phone wasn't working, and he could not get hold of any of his family members to tell them or to vent that he was just feeling unwell. And he couldn't get any help out there. He'd actually thought that his co-workers were angry with him, and he was afraid of everyone at the work camp. He thought that they were out to get him. And so, on the night of June 30th, Daniel had started to hear voices, and he had heard them in the past before, but this was very different. He couldn't sleep, and the voices continued to get louder and angrier. So he had gotten up and went into the kitchen, a place he was familiar with, and had pulled out a 12-inch butcher knife off of the wall and took it back to his room. As the night went on, he had traveled down a darker path in his mind and grew more and more anxious. Forensic psychologist Dr. Zedvoka had spoken with him, and Daniel said that the voices were there on a daily basis, but became so overwhelmingly strong. His interpretation of things that he'd heard that night went on the terms of what he thought was kill or be killed. And he felt that the voices were warning him that something was going to happen and he needed to defend himself. He had ended up hearing footsteps just outside his door. And remember, most of these camps have a lot of people in them, and you don't know who you are sleeping next to. When he'd heard these footsteps outside of his doorway into the hall, the voices he heard in his mind told him, "Now is your chance." He was experiencing extremely paranoid delusions and felt as if he was a hunter. And the footsteps that he had heard were from 37-year-old Dave Dirksen, who just happened to be walking down the hall. Could have been filling up his water. Who knows? I don't actually know how big of a camp this specific one was. I don't even know the full name of it. Usually, you're in one and there's five or six different names for it. was wearing an anesthesia mask and that he was a surgeon. He then started cutting into his abdomen, but realized he knew nothing of the human anatomy, and he wasn't a doctor after all. He was imagining that he was. And as he would stab him, he would then take the blood and smear it on himself. He had then began removing his organs from his body. He had told Dr. Zetkova that he kept cutting to see the inside of the body to find the heart, because he needed to destroy it if it was still beating. He had then removed an eyeball from the victim because he wanted to see what a real human skull looked like, because he thought that skulls were cool. And I would just like to point out, because we will be going into this, that many, many people saw and heard everything and even tried to stop him. One of the men who had actually initially seen and tried to stop Daniel from doing what he was doing ended up pleading with him and saw Daniel lift an organ from his body and lower it into his mouth. Now, a lot of these people that had seen this happening survived and are completely traumatized and scarred from the event for obvious reasons. And we will go into their stories and then continue on with what else happened. But these filled the holes pretty well. So first, there was Timothy Brassard, who was awoken in his camp room when he heard someone screaming, which was actually Dave yelling, "I've been stabbed." Timothy actually opened his door and saw Dave holding his neck and bleeding. Dave yelled to him, "He stabbed me. The cook stabbed me," as he ran. Daniel, the assailant, actually ran into Timothy's room with the knife, but Timothy acted quickly and shoved him out of there. He'd locked the door and says he chose not to step out into the hallway because he knew that there was nothing he could do, so he instinctively protected himself first. He then actually barricaded himself into his room. He saw from his window when Dave ran away, tried to, and actually made it outside, and Daniel followed him and unfortunately caught up. So he did kind of exit, was outside, and Timothy could see what was happening. As he watched the events that were happening, he'd actually barricaded himself into his room, no doubt, and he ended up pushing a couch against the door for more than an hour and leaned against it tightly. There were several others who said that they had witnessed the events from their windows as well, and had all barricaded themselves inside, which is not surprising. And these camp rooms are terribly insulated. I can hear everything, so I'm not surprised every person could see and was watching this happen, because, like I mentioned before, you're so isolated. I can only imagine the feeling of helplessness was very intense. Then there was Dale Holloway, whom had heard the initial screaming like Timothy, but he'd actually stepped outside of his room. When he had heard the screams and he had seen them running down the hall, the man actually crossed from his room. Not sure if it was Timothy or not. There was many people who knew what was happening, negotiate with Daniel. He'd offered him anything, money, cigarettes, his truck, and was begging for him to drop the knife. Anything that he thought would please him. And the "I'm begging you" actually is what caught Daniel's attention. To which he responded, "You're not begging. Get on your knees if you are." And he did. And then he realized the danger he was in and pleaded that he had family, children. But he didn't care. Daniel didn't care. And by that point, Dave was dead. And this is the perspective that you really get to see what Daniel was thinking, maybe, as Dale was on his knees watching him. Daniel started to speak to the victim, whom was deceased. He'd finished stabbing him, and then suddenly switched gears, saying, "Don't worry, man, I'm a paramedic, and I'm here to help you." And it was then that he had reached down and removed parts of his stomach and bowels. Dale, at this point, snapped into reality and ran into his truck with three other men who were waiting for him, and they had all drove away together. So I can imagine how intense that was as he was watching all of that unfold. A couple had also actually encountered him during this attack. Kelly and Mia, a married couple, were walking together outside holding hands while Daniel was on his stabbing rampage. They had witnessed his attack and watched him consume parts of the victim. And he had then grabbed and covered the entire body of Dave's with cardboard, liquid, and then actually set the body on fire, or attempted to. I believe only bits actually caught, and then it went out. The couple, see how the storylines are better afterward. Anyway, the couple who were close by, and others as well, fled into the bushes, some their vehicles if they had their keys on them, and Daniel, actually watching this, would scream towards them, "Come back here, I'm going to get you next." A man named Penner and another worker were also, some of whom heard the events from their rooms. They'd stayed in there before realizing they had to run, and they'd actually overheard someone yelling, "Let him go. He's had enough." And, "Danny, stop." And if this story isn't sad or twisted enough, it's just gonna continue to get sadder. So Daniel, very paranoid, remember, a camp that no one liked him. Everyone was out to get him. And he actually only had one single person at the camp whom he had a good connection with. And that was the voice that they'd heard calling out to Danny. And most of the people at camp, they weren't out to get him, but they didn't like him. They thought he was odd and quiet, and sometimes, in their mind, rude. Except for Hallie Dubois, whom was 50 at the time, and working at the camp as well. I believe, from the articles I read, it came across that she was also a cook at the camp. During the frenzy of events, Hallie had obviously seen and ran to try and help. She ran towards Dave and Daniel, calling out for him to stop. I'm not sure if she witnessed the stabbings or if she was there for the fire. I don't know what happened. It's not clear. But as she called out to him, his only friend, the only person whom he had any connection with, he did end up stabbing and cutting her roughly 11 times on her head, torso, and upper arm. She did try to fight back with defensive injuries on her right hand, and the couple I mentioned earlier, Kelly and Mia, actually heard Hallie calling out their names a bit later after she'd been stabbed. I'm not sure exactly the timeline of this. I have a theory later on, but I'm sure once they felt it was safe to do so, they did go to her. Kelly had cradled her head in his lap as she began to fade, and before she passed, she told him, said he believes that he lit the place on fire, and my thoughts were he was trying to burn us all out. It was then that Timothy ran for his truck. As he got in and locked the door, Daniel was actually just at the driver's side window looking in, but he was safe to drive away. But when he did try and drive away, the speed off, Daniel did chase after him. But after about 30 meters, Daniel could not keep up, which is when I believe Kelly would probably have went to console Hallie, whom, by the way, did pass away. When Timothy, who was driving, went further down the road, a pair of RCMP cruisers actually stopped him, and the work camp was about 50 kilometers southwest of Fox Creek. So, very remote. Nothing really super close by, and I'm not sure if it was Timothy that directed the officers to the camp, or if they were already on their way there, or somebody called, but for sure, the RCMP arrived at the work camp at 1:50 a.m. The RCMP, by the way, is the Royal Canadian Mounted Police, the Mounties. The officers had known that there were two dead on site, and that the suspect was roaming through the work camp with a knife in hand. Now, according to the statements, when the officers spotted Daniel, he looked at them, calmly turned, and walked away. And if I was here, I can't even, like, stop and do my normal, like, segments where I chime in and chat, because I can imagine it so easily, and it literally freaks me out. I don't know who works here. I don't know who's farting in the room next to me so loudly. I don't have a clue how long whomever walking by has been here and how much longer they have on site, or if they don't even know when they're leaving. So it's honestly just terrifying. Yeah, just this one really getting to me. So he actually got within striking distance of the officers and refused to drop the knife, even after being told to several times. Ultimately, the officers had then opened fire. He was trying to consume people and murdering them, so there's your little segue that I normally do. You know, they opened fire. He was eating people and not obeying. He then fell to the ground, and the officers approached him to remove the knife. Daniel's eyes were closed, but when Constable Bradley Schramm touched the knife with his baton, his eyes opened back up, and he had swung towards him, trying to slice him with the knife. Schramm's partner, however, fired again, and Daniel had fell to the ground, and they had successfully removed the weapon from him. The officers were later cleared of any wrongdoing by the Alberta Serious Incident Response Team, because, of course, they have guns, they're opening fire at someone with a knife, you know. An EMS worker who had actually arrived and had taken Daniel into an air ambulance was assessing him and had actually asked him if he knew why he was in the ambulance. And he responded saying, "Yes, I just killed a guy. Actually, I killed two people." And when the worker asked him why he killed them, he responded by saying, "I just wanted some excitement." So, this story is a lot for me, not only because I'm in a work camp, and that is creepy to me, very creepy. I did it for the ambiance of you to wait, but didn't realize how scary that would be for me. was his own breed, and that's why I just always like to insert these disclaimers that just because a few of them do this does not mean they're all like that. So Daniel was taken away, but the victims are forever changed. They have severe anxiety, insomnia, PTSD, depression. Some say they can't hear loud noises anymore, sleep, go bowling. So a lot of them turn their homes into fortresses. They won't leave their house. They can't open doors because they're scared of what may be behind it. That would scar anybody, and they were terrorized, as well as the victims and the families who had heard that these things happened to their loved ones. Hallie's mother, for example, dreams of her every night calling for her, and it's just never over for them. A trial was held, and Daniel pleaded not guilty due to mental disorder to the charges of first-degree murder, assault with a weapon, and interfering with human remains. Many of the people I mentioned previously testified in courts, and in November of, I believe, 2018, not that long ago, he was found not criminally responsible due to a mental disorder on 2 counts of first-degree murder, 3 counts of assault with a weapon, and interfering with human rights. So, since he was not criminally responsible, he has been held at Alberta Hospital in Edmonton. He'd had a hearing in June of 2019, and the Alberta Review Board said that Daniel, who had been officially diagnosed at this point with schizophrenia and cannabis use disorder, continues to pose a risk to public safety. The board had stated that it is in the opinion of the board that while he is currently being treated and is exhibiting no active symptoms, the risk of relapse is very high, and that should he relapse, he is likely to commit a violent act against a member of the public. He is a significant risk to the safety of the public. And although he's being held at Alberta Hospital on full warrants, he's been allowed to make supervised visits to Edmonton, and even has unsupervised ground privileges while at the hospital. They stated that his behavior during all supervised visits were passed as excellent, and that the description of his team, he may receive even more freedom in the future. He receives monthly injections of antipsychotics and tests for cannabis. His current mental status remains free of any psychotic symptoms, and his mood is appropriate with evidence of mania or depression. He is polite and reasonable on approach, and attends activities with cooperative fashion. So, most of the victims who were actually there to witness everything that had happened have heard this, have heard that he is possibly allowed more freedom, and they are obviously furious and incredibly uncomfortable. A lot of them live in Edmonton, where he currently is, and yeah, they hate the idea of him being out. They've turned their homes into fortresses, so I can see how for them it's very triggering to hear these things. It's actually Hallie's mother, who attends every single hearing, and herself actually admitted and said how surprised she was at how much Daniel had actually changed from just a month after his trial. She even said, "How is it that Daniel was just a shell of a person with no feelings? And in a few short weeks, you could say he's almost vibrant and even a different person." He did actually go and try to apologize to her, and she said to him, "Don't be sorry, because if you're looking for me to forgive you, that's never going to happen." He destroyed her life, and yeah, she did see a change and admitted that, but constantly worries correctional services, and they believe that if he were to be released, his stress levels would increase in the face of no established support. And they expect that in unstable circumstances, he'd easily stop treatments, and in a decompensated mental state would eventually become violent again. And that is where we are today with everything. They were supposed to meet, I believe, sometime in 2020. I'm not sure if that happened, as it has not been, I couldn't find it anywhere. And yeah, it blows my mind how little of people have heard of that story. It's just such a big thing that at least happened in my area, and I feel so bad for everyone involved. So when your story's like this.